defines each and every person separate. Each and everybody else's beliefs are different. That's why we have so many religions, so many fights, and it has not taken us anywhere closer. Forget about closer, but away from Paramatma. All this carnage, millions of people dying and killing, and one empire coming and then going and building temples, and one temple destroyed, another temple on top of that. All this stupidity has been going on for thousands of years. The only time we understand that something else has to happen is when you understand the futility of all these things. So the disturbances of the body will destroy you, and at the same time, disturbances of the mind will also disturb you. All these disturbances, when disappear, the soul starts shining. Because it's like a clean water. When it's disturbed with impurities, it will never realize its clean nature. So there was a beautiful saying by Sogyal Rinpoche. He was a Buddhist monk. And he says, water, if you don't stir it, will become clear. The mind, left unaltered, will find its own natural peace. So the mind is peace, because it's a product of soul, and soul is at peace. The reason we don't find the soul, because we are so occupied with the dance of the mind. When we understand the futility of that dance, because we want to create, we're trying to mimic Paramatma. The creation is happening. It's not done by anybody, not even by God. Creation is God. Change is God. God doesn't have a will to create. It's in its nature to create. So even God does not have his own ego. And in our stupidity, we have created gods with their own face and then or their mustache and beards and appearance is different, and everybody has given ego to the God even, that God will punish you, God will do this and God will do that. He's not a doer. He's a non-doer. And until we all become non-doer, the clear water will never happen. In that clarity of the mind, Lord sings, you become God. But at that level, everything drops. Ego is total fake. When ego does not exist at your level, do not think that ego exists at the God level either. He does not have any agenda in the mind that I want to do this and I want to do this. Forget about all these things. That cannot be God. Because when he performs with the ego level, he's choosing. God cannot choose. He's infinite. How can he choose you over me? It is happening. That happening, we have to understand, the happening, the creation, is the dance of creation, is God. But to understand all these things, we have to butt out. We have to remove ourselves from the equation. And that removing ourselves is the dropping of the ego. That's the fake dance of the mind. When the mind is dancing its own tunes, it cannot synchronize with the dance of Paramatma. Because when you synchronize at that level, nothing exists. Only thing that exists is the existence and constant change that is happening without choice. It's just happening in the right direction. Whatever direction it comes in, the existence itself is God. So the question comes that why we cannot meditate, why we cannot go in that direction, because we are too preoccupied with the body or the mind. The body and mind has kept us so much occupied that the possibility of rise of soul or spirituality does not happen. So until we appease the body and appease the mind, it cannot happen. Now, there is a conflict between body and mind. It is understandable. Like we said, an empty stomach, he cannot watch a concert. you have to be satisfied, then you can enjoy the pleasures of a concert or a dance or whatever, right? So in the past, the life of a mind was possible for only the kings, because there was so much poverty. Most of the people were so busy filling their own stomachs, they never had a chance to appreciate the poems of the poets and paintings of artists and things like that. That's why those people existed only in the king's courts. You know, we say that, oh, the kings were, this king was so good, he let the art flourish in his, because he was the only one who could do it. The rest of the people, where did the art exist? For them, art creation of the art was just to make a living. So the body needs were so simple, but it was very difficult to meet in those days. So what happens is, if you stay occupied with the body, the mind's pleasures would not mean anything to you. Even if you have it, what do you care? A lot of paintings and all these things we appreciate right now, most of the paintings were created by the great painters just to survive. For them, it was not an art. For us, it's an art, because our body needs are met now. The science has made sure that everybody is well-fed and basic needs are met. So now we're looking more into the pleasures and all correct. These millions of dollar correct. Van Gogh paintings, you know, don't mean anything to the painter himself, right? So there was a story like two students went to an artist who was a master, and they wanted to learn the art of painting from him. But the teacher said, I need to be paid. None of them had any money, but they really had a desire to learn how to paint. And they were very good, close friends. So what they decided was, one guy will work and make a living, will support the fees for learning. And teacher said, listen, I don't want anything for myself, but at least the basic material, the paint, color. And the colors, the crayons, all these things has to be bought. And there is a money that is involved, so there is an expense. So he says, okay, one guy will work for 5 years, and meanwhile he will learn the art of painting from the master. At the end of 5 years, you will change the roles, and then you teach me by that time, at that time. So this is how it will go, and we both will learn the art of painting. So the process starts. One guy becomes a student, he's learning 24/7, staying with the master, while the other guy is working really hard labor to really make a living, make some money so that they can pay for the material. At the end of 5 years, the guy became a great artist, was very happy, thanked the master, and then went to his friend that, I cannot thank you enough because you did all this hard work for me, but now it is my turn to pay the dues. So I will teach you. Let's start painting. 5 years of hard work, lifting the quarry stones, had destroyed his hands. The hands were so used to lifting the heavy stuff, could not hold the stroke of brush, because it requires the finesse. The art has to flourish only when the fingers move. He says, it's too late. My 5 years of hard work and manual labor has left me incapable of using the brush strokes. So that was the end of that. So the lesson that we learned is, if you remain too preoccupied at the body level, mind dies. At that level, desires for the mind to even learn the art, forget about performing on the art, is gone. Because the body gets into that routine that it never now even dreams about going any further. So that tells us that to remain occupied at the body level or the mind level too much will never let us have the desire to go to the spiritual level. So before that happens, before we get preoccupied by the body or the mind, this is our chance to think of the spiritual level and start realizing the futility of all these things that we are trying to do using the body, using the mind, trying to create all these things. This is the time to invest our time and efforts into the spirituality. But people always have an excuse that I cannot meditate, because again, too busy with the body or the mind. And body and the mind, like I said, there is always a conflict because they both deal with matter. You have to understand. The body, of course, needs matter. Body is a matter. Body is created by the matter. Body gets rid of the matter. Body will end up as a food for someone else. And all that process goes on. Body is a continuous involvement in the matter. What is mind? Mind thinks about material objects. Some kind of material. People, objects, situations, all created by the matter. So mind is still involved in the matter. So there is always a conflict. Like I said, whether you have the basic needs of the body, and if you're too preoccupied with that, the mind has to take a step back. Mind has to stay behind until the body. So same way, there is a conflict. So time and space will always conflict with each other. So time and space will not let body or the mind be happy at the same time. It's a very delicate balance to keep the body and mind occupied, satisfied both, right? Because there's always a possibility of excess. The body, fine. The mind will destroy the body by the excess. It wants this and it wants that and all that. So that constant will go on. So time and space interactions will always find a conflict between the body and the mind. Body will suffer because of the actions of the mind. So all these things is happening. But the spiritual level is another story. Because spirit does not deal with matter. Matter is controlled by the time and space. Space creates matter. Matter creates space, whatever it is. Time is created by matter. Matter creates time. Time creates matter. We don't know. After certain years, new matter is changed, this matter is changed, all that. But it's an interplay. Time and space are built into the matter. Space is defined by two material objects, the space in between. So space is created by the matter. Time is interplay of the material objects. Earth going around the sun creates the illusion of time. So time and space, wherever are used, there's always going to be conflict. So body and mind conflict with each other all the time. But spiritual is another story. It's beyond matter. So we gave an example earlier that if you want to fill up this room with 50 chairs, easy. But if I order another 500 chairs, we may have a problem. So at the matter level, there's going to be a limitation. But if you want to just put a lamp and fill the whole room with light, there is no problem. Life will penetrate every single corner of the room without having any conflict with the 50 chairs or even 500 chairs. Doesn't matter. So we have to understand when we give an excuse that I don't have time, or I don't have any place where I can meditate, it doesn't matter. If you say that, then you don't understand meditation. Meditation is not a conflict at all. Meditation, the conflict, if that is happens for meditation, then the conflict is at the mind level, because we don't understand meditation. Meditation is all about spirituality. Spirit is beyond time, beyond space, so it can happen anytime. Another word of meditation is bhavana. It's bhav. Bhav can penetrate anywhere and anytime. Love can flow anywhere, anytime. It doesn't matter. 2 o'clock in the morning, mom has the same love for the kid, or vice versa. So all these things are bhavana. And meditation is an attitude. Has nothing to do with the time or space. The process or act of meditation has no value, literally, unless we try to give importance to the place so much. You go into meditation and you say the kids are making noise and you get angry and it's useless. Then you are not meditating.
You can go to a jungle and those birds will be chirping, oh, they are bothering me too.
Maybe on you too. So you have to be beyond all the material conditions. Yeah. Then only you meditate. Because meditation is an attitude. You can have attitude of meditating 24/7. It has nothing to do with the act of meditation. So the question is not when to meditate. The question is how to meditate. That we are lacking. So that's why we talked about earlier, this temple was being built and everybody's breaking the stones with a different attitude. One guy is breaking the stones because he hates his job and he has to make a living. Another guy is doing, he says, yeah, I'm doing it, but I'm doing it for my wife and kids because it's my responsibility. So he's feeling a little better because at least he's doing for someone else. Third guy says, well, I'm building a temple for Paramatma. Total different attitude between three people. The same way you can have different attitude living the same life. Some may be hating the life because he has to do it. Somebody says, all right, I'll do it for my family. I have to make a living, this and that and all that. But when you're living it for Paramatma, you're doing all these things, plus you have an attitude of bliss all the time. Then you don't have interactions. You don't have the stress of mind. You don't have anything. Everything is offered to Paramatma. So your day-to-day actions become meditation. So it's very important that we rise ourselves above the traditional vision of life that we see. What we see is nothing compared to what's underneath. What's underneath is a whole complex web of interacting spirit, energy, and ultimate creation of matter, and then that also constantly changing all the time. The whole dance in its perspective is what you are, not just the body, not even just the mind. There is a lot beyond that. And the body and the mind are also part of that Advaita that we have to realize. They are not separate from Advaita either. So that's why we talked about that shloka that we talked about last time. Na asti buddhi ayuktasya. Ayuktasya. Yukta, yuj, means to connect. Yukta is connected. Ayuktasya, somebody who is not connected. Somebody who is still living at the body and the mind level is ayuktasya. So na asti buddhi ayuktasya. Somebody who is not connected to the higher self cannot have buddhi. Buddhi is spiritual knowledge. You cannot have it. As long as you're keeping yourself busy with all these material things, you cannot have buddhi. So na asti buddhi ayuktasya, na cha ayuktasya bhavana. Also, to the ayuktasya, somebody who is not connected, cannot happen bhavana. Bhavana means meditation, the bhav samadhi. The meditation cannot happen to somebody who is not connected. So somebody who is not connected will not have spiritual intelligence, will not be able to meditate because his mind is continuously going, wavering back and forth. Na cha abhavyat shantihi. Until you meditate, you cannot have peace. The suffering is only at the body, at the mind level. So, na abhavyat shantihi ashantasya kutasukham. Without shanti, how can you have peace? So it's the whole complex system. To have total peace and to live with peace, breathe with peace, and peace is freedom. Freedom is peace. Until you are caught as a slave to the body, slave to the mind, and through the mind, slave to the world, the freedom will never happen. Spiritual freedom is the only freedom that you can have. There is no other freedom. And until you are free, you are not happy. And until you are not happy, you cannot have peace. So much for today.
Okay.